So with that, I think it's time for some questions from the audience. We have about 15 minutes. Saikar, would you like to start?
Can I ask you a question?
Sure. Just introduce yourself and mention who you are directing it to.
My name is Saikar. I'm a journalist. One question to Zoheb and one question to Argo. To you, Zoheb, you said that the Aadhaar central database is constantly being attacked, and there are challenges to try to hack it, etc. Now, constant argument that we have, also full disclosure, I have been receiving notices from Aadhaar UIDAI. So, apparently, I am also one of those who tried to breach data and stuff like that. That's a different story. But every time UIDAI tries to counter this, they make the point that they have been mandated, they have been declared a critical database information infrastructure. And therefore, any breach would invoke Section 69F of the Act, which is cyber terrorism, and so 66F of the IT Act, therefore cyber terrorism, etc. So if it is, if so many attempts are being made constantly, where are the cases and why aren't they filing those cases? Because apparently you are trying to attack a critical information infrastructure. And this information asymmetry, if I could have your views on that. To Argo, your question, I mean, we've constantly heard that we sign up on Facebook and Brinda's come up with an excellent counter to that. But my point is, if you are saying that Silicon, they're in the Silicon Valley and they're beyond Indian jurisdiction, whose failure is that? And to illustrate this question is, 500,000 Indians' data was taken away under Cambridge Analytica. The minister of IT said on Twitter and elsewhere that I will take action and I'll file an FIR, but by the time it came to that, what action have you taken? His response was, oh, we've got some response from Facebook, but we can't reveal to Indian citizens what that response is. Again, when you see these gaps, then whose failure is it? And my final question is that Section 57, one theory is that it's wholly unconstitutional. Some are saying, no, it's a legislative failure. It can be corrected. So if I could have some views on that.
Right. We could take a few more questions and then come back to both of you. Manish?
I have only one central question. One thing in this judgment is really the spectacular dissonance
between the majority and the dissent on facts, right? And it's one thing to have like a substantial dissent on a question of law. And some of this, as you have discussed, came from the way evidence was appreciated and on the weightage perhaps that was given to what the state said. Do you have some thoughts on that? And what does this mean moving forward in rights cases for the court, right? What does it mean in a writ petition involving contested questions of fact? How is the court to adjudicate such questions?
Sir, you have a question.
Oh, well, I'm Suresh Panje, also a journalist. I have two questions, please. This may not be in the actual context of today's topic. I wish to know the relevance of Aadhaar card in the context of Assam's exercise of NCR. That is one. And the second is about 5 years ago, the government started outsourcing issuance of Aadhaar card based on the ration card, Sheshan card. Sheshan card is a voter's card for this Nandan card, Nandan Nilekani's card. Okay. Without any verification. So what are your views, please?
Right. So
post verification, post issue verification.
So would you like to go first on the multiple questions?
Okay. Sorry, what was this first? Okay. So Manish, like Orgo also said, that there is a certain level of deference to the state and the state's data that is being said, that is given when a parliamentary law is under challenge. which is why you also see two kinds of approach, even in the majority, to circulars and rules, which have been seen not as substantive law or plenary law, but as executive action, and to law passed by Parliament, like the Income Tax Act and the Aadhaar Act. So that apart, as far as the data is concerned, by and large, the data that was put forward before the court was data prepared by authorities, which data have not been contested. I'm not talking about the savings data. I'm talking about the data as far as ration cards, bogus ration cards, etc., that were concerned. Per se, that data, maybe the methodology and the kind of exclusions, etc., were debated upon. But that was not contested and that was not disputed. And finally, the majority has therefore given deference. There is also something which is like the presumption of constitutionality. So you presume, and therefore the burden on the petitioners becomes all the more higher. And as far as the affidavits were concerned, by and large, they were on exclusion. And those have been considered by the majority. And considered, and the judgment, it is presumed that they've considered it, and therefore
all right.
No, because it has
presumption
to be,
of consideration,
it has that the Supreme Court way back in Govind Raju Mudaliar, Supreme Court says that every ground, every argument, it is impossible. Petitioners took 29 days or 28 days to argue every single 20 in rebuttal, also 3 days. So, I mean, it was every single ground cannot be addressed in a judgment. Therefore, it is presumed that it has been considered and it is central to its reasoning, which is why the court has given extreme emphasis on the fact that there should not be any exclusions on the ground. And some measures, I believe that any responsible government will have to take serious measures. And we have to understand the state governments are the implementing authorities for as far as this food subsidy, etc., is concerned, and they will really have to firm up their act and ensure that there are no exclusions. And also, every dispute can't be resolved through courts. Assuming this project is not working at all, large scale authentication failures are happening, people are being denied food, who will vote that government back into power? So there will be democratic impacts, there will be democratic processes that will happen. So, I mean, that's fine.
But the legislation will be there, irrespective the government may not be in power. We must not forget that.
Would you like to respond to Saikat's queries?
So point on Manish is that I think the Supreme Court should consider swapping places with Patiala House. That seems to be one way in which it can properly appreciate evidence, because I think that this is actually a genuine problem as far as the structural nature of the court is concerned. As in, if they are going to hear arguments and they are going to allow arguments for 35 days to be made, then I do think that it creates some expectation that people who have researched and so on, as in that it will find place in the judgment in some shape or form. And now we also know that that's also not going to be possible. So I think there are two ways in which we should think about larger restructuring, because I think the court, we must recognize the fact, whether right or wrong, we can be on different sides on this, but the Supreme Court has gone way beyond being a court of law. As in, it's a court of everything. Okay, so it's a final court of everything. And given that that's the case, I think there should be a couple of structural innovations that should be considered. I think certainly now that we have PIL cases which are more adversarial, earlier we had PIL cases which were less adversarial, I think there should be a more structured use of court commissioners, not appointing amici in an ad hoc way, but a more structured use of court commissioners. And I think related to that, I think there really should be a time limit for arguments in court. As in, I think if we can do it in weighty questions of law in other countries, I see absolutely no reason, no matter how important Aadhaar may be or the NJC may be, to be spending 35 days on this. As in, it just boggles my mind. Saikat, as far as your question is concerned, whose failure is Indian data breach in Cambridge Analytica? I think it's primarily, as your question hints, as in it is first a failure of the state. Yes, there's no doubt about the fact that it's a failure of the state. And the reason why it's a failure of the state is not directly in terms of how did the breach happen, because obviously the state didn't per se have a role to play in that breach taking place. But what the state does have a role to play is that it does not have the regulatory framework in place in order to either prevent that breach in some shape or form or to penalize against that breach. So neither do we have a any kind of norms which require these companies to either store their data here or in order to locate here, number one. Number two is that despite all our hoo-ha about being a great IT superpower, the fact is that none of these companies, which are the largest IT companies, are companies. So the fact is that one, so it's not a surprise that the law minister couldn't do anything at the end of it. My sense is that he shouldn't have made that statement because it's not something that he could have done. But I think it's also important to state here that there is a responsibility that each one of us as individuals also has. I don't think that in this digital age we can simply, especially knowing the failings of our state, as in simply pass on the responsibility to the state to protect. I think the state must protect. By all means, the state must protect. But the fact is that we must, as individuals, be more vigilant about our own privacy and not simply privilege efficiency over it. As far as the third point about without verification is concerned, as you know, as an Aadhaar can be given on the basis of three types of methods. Zoe, please correct me if I'm wrong. And then the first is through some other kind of documentation that is being provided. And most Aadhaar is given on the basis of some other kind of documentation, whether it be ration card or session card, whatever it may be. There is also a method which is an introducer-based mechanism by which someone can go and introduce you. And the third is, I think, by verification by a government officer or some such thing like that. Yeah. So the point is that most Aadhaar numbers have been given on the basis of some established POI or POA document. Okay. Now, I agree with you that that document itself may be may be a fraudulent document. But as I said, and I think this we're trying to say is that this is not a magic wand. It has been portrayed in some quarters even to support it as a magic wand. It is not a magic wand. And I hope that with this judgment, there is some degree of realistic expectations on both sides as to what it is and equally importantly as to what it's not.
I think all of you have a lot of questions reserved, but we are sort of running short of time. So I'd request you to, you know, confine to any questions directly related to the verdict. If there is any doubts on the verdict, if anyone has a query, then we can sorry.
Yeah, I think from the course of the discussion, this question that Mr. Manish also brought forward, the question of facts certainly became very central to the outcome itself. So I wanted to hear the views of anybody on the panel about whether the question of imposing a burden of proof in such situations, let's say you can't expect the institution to carry out, the Supreme Court itself to carry out evidence gathering, what can be considered the legitimate duties of the parties in terms of burdens when it comes to the fact? And where should it lie? And could you maybe run through the proportionality test to show which parts of it might be the burden of which party? Is it, as I understand ordinarily, that violation is on petitioners, reasonable restriction is on the state, or is it something different with proportionality?
Do you have a question?
Yeah.
On the verdict?
Yes.
Sure.
The question is pertinent to Section 57. So my first question is that since you mentioned the number of safeguards that are there when a private party is using Section 57 to authenticate, and one of the key privacy concerns there was the authentication logs that are being created which enable surveillance, my primary question was that once you get rid of the idea of a permanent authentication log, which has been done by the judgment, why in addition to that do we need to strike down usage of Section 57 by private parties, because what is that additional privacy harm that is sought to be addressed there? And my other question again on Section 57 itself is to Orgho, because since you said that the way forward is a consent-based framework, so I was wondering if your reading of the judgment therefore is that as far as Section 57 is concerned, it is possible to bring in a law that provides for a consent-based framework for private parties to use Aadhaar-based authentication services, since there has been some debate on that interpretation.
So actually, sorry, just to take the mic, and I would be interested, I mean, going back to, I think, Saika's question also, in terms of the different interpretations of what 57 says, and I'd written on this as well when this whole issue had come out, and in my view, I think there is only one interpretation, so I'd be intrigued if you sort of agree with this or not, which is that there were four broad reasons why 57 was struck down. First, as I said, money bit. Now, I'm not going on the merits or demerits of should it have been struck down or not, but just sort of what the implication is. So one of them is, as I pointed out, the act came as a money bill. So having come as a money bill, 57 is really outside the purview of that. The text of Section 57, I don't have it with me, but broadly talked about any purpose. So it could be used for any purpose. And so one of the arguments was any purpose means every purpose. So the purpose was unspecified, and that was one of the problems. The second issue was, law or contract. And, that's when, again, this discussion came about whether you need it by law or could contract be enough. And that's why this, when Arun Jaitley gave his speech and sort of indicated that maybe a law will be brought in, that is meant to say that now that if we bring in a law, this issue will not arise. And the third part is commercial exploitation. So both Justice Sikri, speaking for the majority, and Justice Chandrachud talk about this idea of commercial exploitation of data. And as one of, as another reason to strike down 57. And according to me, when you read these four factors together, there is only one conclusion, that 57 cannot be brought back. A lot of the people who were saying that 57 can be brought back are relying on this one paragraph in Justice Sikri's opinion, where he says that the respondents may be correct, that it may be voluntary. 367, 371. So they rely on this para of Justice Sikri's opinion to say that, to take a contrary stand, which is that he said that the respondents may be correct in this view. And when we had written on this piece, we had said that that has to be seen in context of his entire conclusions. And his conclusion, sort of in his last concluding summary, actually makes it quite clear that 57 has been struck down for private parties as well. And I think, so that's my interpretation, that it cannot be brought back. And I think this just goes a bit to how the judgment was written, that I think 57's discussion is sort of all over the place. It's there in five different areas, so it's not discussed in one comprehensive manner, which is leading to this confusion. But, I'd be intrigued if you disagree.
No, I agree completely. All the points that you've stated of the reasons for striking down 57, money bill, any purpose being too broad and open-ended, it being a contract, therefore there's no legitimate state interest, commercial exploitation. There is one more reason, which I felt from a close reading of it, is that Justice Sikri was really concerned about it not being a genuine choice in a contract. Therefore, he uses the expression coercive consent. And that there could be contract, for instance, if an employee goes for an employment, somebody may say, give an Aadhaar, otherwise there's the door.
Right.
So or somebody goes to a hospital, they say, give an Aadhaar or else give birth on the road. So I think, and those were things that were happening at that time, so they were topical. I think that is what was the real concern, which means that it's not a genuine contract, because a genuine contract, Section 10 of the Contract Act, means as consensus ad idem, consent of parties. So I think coercive consent is also another reason to add there.
Ms. Arora, just on the last point of difficulties in, gathering facts, right, after years of experience before the Supreme Court, and considering Orgo's point that the court has really evolved today, right? I mean, PIL is no longer what it used to be even 20 years ago. How do you think we can resolve this as a final, point before we close the panel in terms of gathering facts? What do you think are the procedural innovations required, or if at all is possible?
I would only agree with what Brinda said some time back. There were two set of facts, a PowerPoint that the government projected, and a huge documentary facts and affidavits that were given on this side. Now, either the court should take all of them and then deal with them, or then debunk all of it and go on a pure legal basis. Supreme Court by itself, for it to invite facts or evidence before it, it's not going to happen. I don't see that happening. So therefore, rightly so, in writ jurisdictions, the court says, well, no disputed facts before us. But if it is entering into the arena of facts which are disputed, then I think there is a responsibility there on the court to deal with both set of facts and not just one. Is where I would...
If I... Sorry.
On this point.
If I may add something, like Orgo pointed out, that appointment of local commissioners may also be a very effective way, where you appoint people who you believe will do an independent and thorough job. And I must, there's no chest thumping involved, but I must point out that I was appointed as a local commissioner in an Aadhaar matter where I was representing Aadhaar before the Delhi High Court in a right to food case. And there I had to go to all these bastis in Malviyanagar and Delhi regarding as far as denials were concerned. And I presented a report, and that has in fact been relied upon by the petitioners in the Supreme Court. So I think that is an effective way if people can thoroughly, because there is no other way to do a fact finding.
Thank you all. I mean, it's been last point.
There's one question.
I had a short question which goes beyond the judgment. I wanted to ask Mrs. Arora, since she referred to the Nazis and the Jews, could you perhaps highlight some of your potential worries as far as the political implications, dimensions are concerned, and how could it be misused also in the political battle unfolding in the country? My name is Dr. Klaus Voll. I'm living here since 83.
Why I say so is this, that the government admits that every single information about every single individual is stored in different silos. It says that the convergence of silos is possible, but the law says we will not do it. So if you have a number of a political dissent or a group of dissenters, there are various ways of affecting them. If the number is deleted as an Aadhaar, because that is your only identification, then you as an individual virtually cease to exist. You won't be able to access anything thereafter. That's one facet. The second facet comes from here. This is a platform where I would not have wanted to speak about it, but you asked me a question and I'm answering that. We have had past precedents where the municipal records were used to identify persons of a given community living in certain places, and in matters of mob violence, only those places were attacked. This has happened also in Germany. The records of the municipalities were used to identify the homes of the community, and then they were picked up from there. This has happened in India too. But just think that when you have the numbers of Aadhaar, how easy it is to identify and profile a person completely, much more than what you could do with only the municipal records. That's where I leave.
But I think finally what really emerges is that when it comes to technology, there are huge conflicts between rights and technology, between innovation and rights. And it's, we are still going through a very nascent stage where we are trying to figure out how to strike the right set of balances. Even with Aadhaar, the battle doesn't end here. There's Professor Shamnath Bashir's petition pending before the Delhi High Court, which raises a different set of questions on data security, hacking by China, various possibilities with the CIDR, and the set of data security practices that UIDAI has been following. So I think as citizens, all we can really do is to constantly engage with this, either through forums like this, or filing PILs, or to, you know, constantly evaluate what regulators like the UIDAI are doing and to track the data and respond. On behalf of Center for Policy Research, I'm grateful to all the panelists today for taking their valuable time out Friday evening again, and you know, to enlighten all of us. Thank you so much.